Hey everybody, nice to be here. First time in Kiev, first time in Ukraine. It's a really nice experience. And so today the title is Peace is Just and Free-to-Play Game, Using Games to Deal with Conflicts. Yeah, it's an interesting title, but I'll mostly talk today a little bit about myself, but mostly about games from all around the world that deal with conflicts, wars, prejudice, and the sorts. So let's start. So hi, as you mentioned, nice to meet you. I'm Tsahi. I'm the headmaster of the biggest game development and game design school in Israel, running for 3 years program. We teach our students Unreal and Unity game engines and art, game design. We just opened an AR/VR course, the first one in Israel. So it's really interesting. I just was with several of my students in Finland for the last 10 days, visiting all the big studios, Supercell, Seriously, Housemarque. So it was really interesting for them and for me. And we won 3 first prizes in the biggest hackathon that was there. So it was quite an experience. I'm also the VP Foreign Affairs for GameIS. GameIS is the Israeli Game Developers Association, so everything connected to games, connecting Israel to other game industries around the world, connecting investors to Israeli companies, going to conferences to speak about our industry. We are doing that voluntarily for the last 11 years in Israel. We have our own conference, mostly it's around September, so we welcome if you'll be around. And I'm also the head of Funnel Entertainment Studio, which is a game studio that comprises out of my students that is in Tiltan School. A little bit about my experience. So I've been working in the game industry for the last 14 years, maybe almost 15. My expertise is mostly educational games for children. I work with like some big names like Sesame Street, building games for even India and other third world countries. I work with Nickelodeon, BBC, PBS Kids. It's always interesting to make children happy and try to educate in a very fun way. And if you played some of those games or some of those, you know, Dexter, some of those, like Soccer Stars, was projects that I was involved, Mike the Knight, and of course, Kerbers and Strawberry, Candy Garden, Strawberry's Shortcake, so that were some of my projects. So today, we'll speak a little bit about what is a conflict, what are its types, what triggers a conflict, very shortly, and later on, most of my presentation will be showcasing games and examples for conflict, wars, and other interesting games around the world from countries, and later on, conclusions. So what is a conflict? So a conflict is a situation where two people or two groups are not agreeing on something and taking that into a violent solution, whether it's a physical violent or it's actually word or discussions violence. It's essentially a clash between two groups. And just this picture showed the types of conflicts we have in our world, starting with cyber attacks to narco to global tension, global warming conflicts. It's I think it's not updated, the situation today. It's a picture from 2 years ago, and I think the situation is worse today, more red. There are 4 types of conflicts, and mostly in my presentation, I will deal with the man versus man conflict, not just, you know, an inner conflict a person have with himself or a crimes that a man does against the society or nature. Let's speak a little bit about why, like the reasons for conflict. So first of all, the first reason I see is superiority. There are several groups, and we could see in history groups that thought that they are superior to other nations and other groups. They thought they are the chosen ones. They thought they are very special. That's one, like the KKK or white supremacy. They thought they are better, they are the ruling race. Still exists, sadly, in the US. Second one, of course, I will not say anything about the Nazis. A Jewish, I experienced that firsthand, or let's say my ancestors and my grandfather and his family. So it's a very risky situation when you think you are superior and all others needs to either be enslaved or be changed in order to try to be somewhere in between your status and theirs. Scientology, yeah, that's a very weird comparison, but yeah, they are assuming that they are being controlled by like an alien deity that dictates their movements, and all the other people should change their mindsets into theirs. The second reason is injustice. We feel like somebody is treating us with unjust. If we take the example, for example, of the IRA, this is a good example, being depressed for many years by the English, being treated in a very horrid way, and they rebelled against the system for many years. They've been considered a terror organization, but then again, some of the reasons were really interesting. The Black Panthers, if you know, it started in the Malcolm X era, and actually there was an Israeli movement called the same, like the Black Panthers, that rebelled against the government. Jewish people from Yemen, from Iraq, from Iran are being prejudiced versus people from Poland and from Eastern Europe. So that was the same reasons, the same movement, even the same physical violence. And it's they are still actually a little bit active in Israel till those days. Vulnerability. So that's about people that feel that they are being they have vulnerability versus other groups of people. They are speaking about a specific ideal, and for example, people that are protesting versus climate change, or activists, nature activists mostly, or gay rights. Right, they are normal people like everybody else, but they are being treated for many decades, and in some countries they are still outside of the law. So it's that could lead for, you know, many conflicts. And in Israel there was a debate, although Tel Aviv is very open-minded and Israel is very open-minded versus gay rights, you would still see like clashes from time to time, especially with the religious groups that believe that religiously gay rights is a sickness, which is sad. Distrust. So I can take, for example, Occupy Wall Street's protests, where we distrust the government, we distrust other groups that are trying, in our belief, to harm us or to put us in risk or in harm way. This was a protest, one of the biggest in Israel. I think almost a million people go out the streets to protest against the government, that they didn't trust its economic policy. And I think we managed to change several things, although we don't see that so much now, it's actually reversing. But it was one of the very interesting movements. It existed for like half a month or something. Of course, Trump, I will say no more. I hope there is no American here. But yeah, there's still many protests around the world, and especially in the US in several parts, versus Donald Trump policy that always or mostly dictates towards hate and separation. Helplessness, that's a situation where we feel like we're helpless. Somebody else, we are depending on somebody else and we can't do anything about it. Like the situation in Syria, the Syrian refugees going all the way to Europe and have to depend on the mercy of the people that host them. The situation in Rwanda and the genocide that happened there, like so many innocent people, many innocent children are being, you know, ruled by very cruel dictators and have to move and try to evade those murderous rulers. And of course, the Yazidis, which is like they're some kind of Muslim cult which have been killed massively by Iraqian and ISIS from both sides, and they just want to, you know, live their own way. And it was really harsh to see their situation. They actually managed to escape and be helped by the US. So that's also very sad. So actually, to sum this all up, what are we fighting for? So mostly it's for funds, money. That's one of the biggest reasons for oil. That's also very very familiar in our area with the Middle East, with Saudi Arabia and other surrounding countries. Water. With the global warming, water is becoming a very rare commodity, and people are actually moving towards rivers and ocean close locations. Religion, maybe the top reason for, you know, differences between who believes in the right God or not, and land. Military power, of course, it's just derived from all those reasons, and just for egos. And for me, I believe that everything starts with fear. As Yoda said, fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, hate leads to suffering and agony. And eventually, when we start our situation like that, looking on other groups which are in conflict, we just want everything. We want their land, we want to conquer them, we want to rule their opinion, we want to dictate how they live, and eventually, sadly, the situation and the solution is to exterminate, like the Daleks trying to do most of the times. How to confront a conflict? So there are several ways. I can write or read books about it and try to create videos for YouTube and try to persuade other people in my situation as someone that has been prosecuted. I can protest. I can go out to the streets and showcase, hey, this is not right, and try to maybe even violently prove my point. I can discuss it in the social network, but that's, you know, only for a very close inner circle. And in my opinion, one of the most effective reasons is to play and create games. And that way I can showcase my point and actually interact and try to put myself in the sides, in the shoes of the other side that has been prosecuted, and show them emotionally what it's like to be, what it's like to sacrifice my family, my home, my ideal, and to be humiliated as one side of the conflict. So first game I'll speak about is Hard Paper's Border, made by two Swedish game developers. It's a very optimistic game where it's a world without borders, and I can live up to a 150 age, and I can travel all around the world, but it's a mysterious world. I have to investigate it and explore it. And from time to time, I have to adjust to the culture in the same country, and I have to decide whether I'll be an activist, or I'll just live my life and don't care about anything that is happening to me. So let's see a very short movie. Video. Ah, that sounds good. Okay, the next game I want to show is called, translation from Arabic, it's Bury Me, My Love. It's actually a song in Arabic that tells the story about Majed and Nora, if I remember right. They are both husband and wife, and they have been separated. He stays in Syria under the conflict, and she decides to flee to Europe. And she tried to find a home. She tried to find a shelter and people to help her along their journey. And the only way to communicate with her husband and with her family is through a cell phone, like a smartphone. And let's see a little bit about it. Thank you. The next game is a game that was really hard for me to play. It's a game by Ubisoft Montreal, and it's called Valiant Hearts. It speaks about World War One, and it's been told by soldiers that wrote letters to their loved ones and didn't manage to come back home from the war. And it's also accompanied by this character, which is a dog that accompanies most of the characters. And I think the game is about five different characters which are presented in the game. It's a very interesting design. I would recommend to play that. Another game, maybe you know it by 11-bit Studio. This is This War of Mine. And it's actually very unique. It took me four times to manage to play that game because it reminded me my time in Lebanon War as a soldier. And it's I think it's one of the first games that showcase you play a group of civilians trying to survive in a under siege house, and at day it's actually influenced by the Bosnia War, and at daytime you cannot go outside because you have snipers aiming at you, so you will be killed. So you have to take care of your resort. You have to build a bed, fix your refrigerator, try to organize like medicines for the other group members. Some of them will die. Some of them will get sick. You have to understand where you put your resources into. And at night you can go out and scavenge, but there are other groups that are scavenging as well. So you're actually stealing from other resorts, and it's a very, that's the harsh cold truth of a war. At war, not only soldiers getting killed or wounded or being affected, also civilians. And it's actually every character here has a face, has a name, has a history, not just a small shooter game where it's just a pile of pixels on the floor. They actually added an extension, which is called The Little Ones, which is even harder to play, because then you have the children in you in that situation, and they ask very tough questions. For example, Grandpa, why do people kill other people? Or why do we have to go scavenge? Why do we have to rob other people in order to survive, of course? But it's you find yourself playing the game in a very different way when you play that extension, because you want to protect the child, so you will sacrifice yourself more for surviving this situation. Quandary is a very interesting game where you are playing a captain that leads a delegation to a new planet. And then you have a collection of builders, scientists, military people, and you have to balance between the decisions. The game is made for children, and it helps you make better decision tree and creates a dialogue between the different members of the delegation to try to build proper life and proper civilization in the world. This is actually very exciting for me. This is Game for Peace. It's a non-profit that I'm a board member at, where we connect Israeli and Palestinian children together through Minecraft game. We just won the first prize of the Global UN competition out of 1,300 projects around the world. And this is actually, that's the way children, which are like 10 or 12, starting, I don't trust Jewish people, they're all liars, or even worse, all Arabs are terrorists. And they start with those opinions. And what we bring them together to play a game of Minecraft together. We added a translation mechanism that they see actually the text that being sent to them in their own language, so that they have no idea if the child they are playing with or against is Arabic or Jewish. And we mix the groups, and very gradually rising the level of the quests they are involved with. It starts very, very low level to try to know each other, and eventually they need to teamwork and to trust one another. And it's actually in Hebrew here, but they say, oh my God, zombies attacked our village, what are we going to do? We have to cooperate in order to defeat them. And eventually, after all of that, we are getting them to meet together physically, to get to know each other. And you can see the change, like the experimental group versus the control group before playing the Game of Peace activities, and after that, it's a huge change for the positive views of one another, and also the willingness to interact and cooperate with each other after the event. And I'll show us, that's the, actually the award that we won, and I'll show us very quickly the plating code.
Thanks to the project Play to Talk, White. Arab and Jewish school Shaking. Children, who are separated into different educational systems in Israel, can change their perceptions of one another. The focus is on reducing prejudices through positive interaction, since negative stereotypic Shaking. Beliefs about the other are still fine. Omnipresent. Play to Talk uses a platform that children immediately feel comfortable with, that of the popular video game Minecraft. In the project, children from a pair of Jewish and Arab schools meet on a weekly basis to play Minecraft together from their school's computer rooms. Rather than having one school play against the other, the children are divided into two teams, each mixed between the two schools. The children are presented with a set of challenges that require increasing levels of cooperation and collaboration. To overcome the language barrier, Minecraft's chat system is equipped with an automatic online translation service. Throughout the program, the virtual world is supplemented by face-to-face meetings where the children discover the real people behind the avatars. The virtual and real-life experiences have a lasting effect.
Okay, back to the next game. So this is also a very interesting game. It's a game being made to tell the story of North Korea and South Korea. It's actually a divided planet called Nanu. Nanu is two worlds in Korean. And it's actually guiding two lovers that have been separated along the journey. And they are looking for each other over the different sides of the planet. And using very harsh metaphoric examples, the children learn about the history of North Korea and the origin of the conflict. Another very similar to Games for Peace project is also an Israeli project, which is the company called Inside Sparks. The game is called Journey to the Fire Mountain. And there you play, the children play part of two tribes that hate each other, Guts. But one day there's a dark force that's trying to actually make them go to war, active war versus one another, and you are playing one of the forest people tribe that is sent to get a magical gem in order to make the two tribes come together. And the through games, gradually we make both tribes and both groups of people, or children in that case, work together towards cooperation. Let's see a little bit.
Two tribes.
It's also true there.
One magic stone. And a long journey to the land of fire.
I don't see that.
Only the one who will learn how to overcome the differences between the tribes will know how to use the powers of each and every one. You will find the magic stones and save the world. The Journey to the Land of Fire workshop is an innovative tool tailored for primary schools, which strengthens skills significant for a better acceptance of the other.
Skip that because it's design. Next game I want to talk about is Nicosia is Calling. It's a game about the conflict between the two sides of Cyprus, and it tells the story also similar to what happened in North Korea. The separation between the two sides and what was before and after traveling in the different sides of Cyprus. And it's meant mainly for children. It's a web game, like Spot the Differences and lots of puzzles in that website. You should go check it out. Another very hard game is a text adventure, 1,000 Days of Syria, that you take the role of one of three characters. One is a journalist, the other is a mother for several children, and the next one is a freedom fighter, and then you play this text adventure in the Syria conflict very differently. Another game is a battle for Donetsk. It tells the story of the battles between Ukraine and Russia. And actually, I really like the message, like, you won the battle, but lost the game. A lot of civilians were killed, which is a huge message. Wherever you play the game, you win the game, but you actually lost. Because you're always losing civilians, no matter what you're trying to do. Darfur is Dying is quite an old game. It talks about the conflicts and the war, I could even say genocide, in Sudan. 400,000 people lost their lives. 2.5 million people were refugees according to that conflict. And in that game, you are trying to survive. You're trying to harvest water. You're trying to collect materials to build your house out of mud, out of other materials. And you are trying to help your children survive and collect food for them. And it's also a very hard game. Most of the times you will lose. Actually hosted several Sudanese refugees in my house for some time. The next game is not a war conflict, but I think at least some of us been a target for bullies at school, or been a bully. Most, I don't know who of you have been a bully. Shame on you. So there's an American game called Awesome Upstandard, being accompanied by a psychologist that speak about how you stand up against the bullying, how you help your children and support them when you spot those kind of circumstances. So the bully is at it again, and then you are joined by your friends that support you against the bully, and then the game teach you how can you become an upstander for that kind of phenomenon. Next game is a interesting VR game that actually puts you in the shoes of either a terror organization activist or an Israeli soldier. And it's had been done, I think, 3 years ago and been tried and tested in several other countries. Let's see a little bit about it. I hope it will not jitter.
This project was born out of frustration as a photojournalist. I have covered conflicts for the last 15 years, and I knew I could not just do the same when I became a father.
I think I'll show it from my folder. Sorry, there's a lot of it here. Where are you? Yes. Okay, let's do it. This is way better.
This project was born out of frustration as a photojournalist. I have covered conflicts for the last 15 years, and I knew I could not just do the same when I became a father. Yet, I was not done with trying to understand wars. My friend in Israel, when they know I'm heading for Gaza, cannot help themselves but to wish me luck and to stay safe. They believe a lot of people in Gaza are irrational. But also when I spend weeks in Gaza working and I'm about to return to Israel, my Palestinian friends are telling me exactly the same. Just be careful there. So there is a bigger story than the war itself, and perhaps this is the one I need to explore and share. This project is rooted in my experience going from one side to the other in many different wars and conflicts, finding that people's dreams, hopes, and nightmares are often more similar than they are different. Who's your enemy? For the audience to understand and feel that, we will use artificial intelligence, cognitive science, and the latest technologies in virtual realities.
בנשק, בדרכים אחרות שיכולות לפגוע בנפש. אם זה ב...
Here is the concept. The Oculus Rift is a virtual reality headset. It blocks your vision and places you in a virtual world that we are creating. Fox Harrell, a professor, and Emil Bruno, a researcher, both from the MIT, will provide the analytical backbone. When the audience walks in between enemies, we will measure bias and how they physiologically respond to the installation. And in using neuroscience research, we could be able to discover how much empathy has been created. I am planning to bring the fighters of seven other long-standing conflicts together in the very same way. You create an enemy as a kid without having met your enemy, because the society around you has created an enemy in the other. So the question is, could I be you if I was on the other side?
Okay. Next game, you probably know that. Papers, Please, by Lucas Pope. It also deals with the country of Autoshka that's been actually made peace with the neighboring country. And you are supposed to, your clerk or an immigration clerk that is needs to decide who is going to enter your country and who is not. And you're mostly biased. If you do mistakes, you're paying that out of your income, and then your family will suffer because of that. Another game is Cloud Chasers, and I think I'll also use my folder to show that because it's jittery here. Okay. At the end. So let's conclude most of that. So if you're making a serious game, especially a game about conflicts, my view is to show the really harsh situation. Don't be gentle, don't sugarcoat it. Try to present the reality and give your players the real situation, because most of the games I see, other than those, are really trying to really take care of our player, shelter it from the real truth. And if you want a change to happen, you need to shock them. They need to feel like a punch to the stomach. Another thing is try to let them play the other side of the conflict. Sometimes it's very effective when you do that. We've seen that in several of the games I presented. It's always hard. For example, in this war of mine, the game is very hard, but sometimes you have like very quiet moments, very gentle moments where you can relax and build in your house and rest a little bit before the next crisis happens. So you need that in your game design. And mostly the end is not happy. It's not a fairy tale, it's not a legend. Most of the times conflicts are ending in a very bloody way, in a very harsh way. So just take care of the road, because the road matters. The way to teach the player about the consequences about the conflict is very important. And also maintain that if you let your player play the game, try to connect them physically, try to use more extensions to the game to let them know about the continuation of the conflict and their outcomes. And yeah, as we shown in Games for Peace, for example, try to connect them together if you can. Sometimes it's not possible, but actually in one of my talks, even when I was speaking at Games for Peace, there were two refugees, like Syrian refugees, and I actually learned more from them about the situation and how they play the game. And of course, you can always connect to other charity organizations. So, if you have any questions, I would like to hear them. If not, I actually have one more video that tells the story of conflicts in Israel, if you want to, if you have time. But questions before that, I think. Do you have? Yeah. Hey, dude.
Hi.
I hear you without the mic, so it's okay.
That slide with the two continents, that game, the art show, not that that
Nano
picture. Before.
Which one? The first one, the Heart Blood.
The first one.
Yeah.
Could you please show it?
Yeah, the slide.
Yeah.
I can. Yeah, sure. I think they actually won the Indie Prize in Casual Connect. And
This one. This art is very specific for some Israeli companies. Yeah. I saw such type of pictures from produced by Israeli companies. Do you know what's the type of art is it?
I don't know the name of the style. I think it's more abstract. It's kind of a more rhetoric kind of art. But it's for sure not made by an Israeli. I know those are Swedish developer and actually husband and wife that made this game. And I don't know, maybe. I don't know an Israeli company that has that.
Thank you.
I can think of, it's not Taptel, it's not other. But if you want, I can connect you to the artist. I know her personally, so it's like most of them.
Hi.
Hey.
I have a question.
Sure.
What's actually the target audience for this game, if this is grown-ups, whether they actually learn from the games or they just take it as a game?
Are you referring to the whole game size show
mostly to the war games that you show that actually show the conflict that, like you have said, that the game that should be developed, they should hurt, they should show the conflict. So who's the target audience for those games?
So it depends. Actually, in some schools around the world, they have been starting to teach what it's called the peace education. And this is actually one fundamental pillar of education, which is learn to, you know, tolerate each other, understand diversity, and even there, if there is a conflict, try to leave, for example, go to that person's village and try to live the life from there point of view. Of course, even with my Arabic friends in Games for Peace, I would never be able to fully understand how they feel and how they live their lives, but I can be close. So if you're asking me if children can be or should be exposed to even the harsh situation shown in the game, I think moderately, yes, they should understand what's going up in the world. Of course, I maybe wouldn't show that to a 6-year-old. I probably be showing that for a 10-year-old or 12-year-old, but actually my daughter, which is 6, knows some of those games, and that, you know, showcase and allow me to answer some of her very hard questions, because, you know, why Israeli and Palestinians are fighting. It's a very complex discussion, but essentially it's mostly about honor and land, because we are so similar, and when the two sides of the conflicts are so similar, it's hard. It's very hard to deal with that, because you are saying, hey, we are actually mostly the same language. We eat the same food. We look like one another. But when you deal with two very proud nations, it's hard. So I think, yes, even if it costs you in a little bit of sorrow, you should do it now, unless you want her to grow up in some fiction of a world that is totally perfect, and then discovering there are conflicts in the world, that there are people that are different from her or from him. So as a father, I try to explain everything, also the very difficult situation in life, like death, and why it happens.
And then, for example, the games that are made for adults, some of them, what's the way actually to promote them to the audience socially? Because I don't think that people would really enjoy or would like to play games where they would realize that this is happening in real life, all the conflict, stuff like this.
This is actually motivates them to maybe contribute in a way, especially if they are game developers. Because when I was speaking, for example, at White Nights and in other conferences, there were several game developers that started because of that. They understood that games can be used for other means than entertainment. And of course, a game should be fun, but eventually they actually changed and some of them started to develop serious games. So I don't think you can fully change a person by letting him like play a serious game, but it's also a gradual process. A grown person will not change his opinions overnight. Even I, when I started, when I was a teenager, I was a very right-wing person. I grew up in a family that told me, there is a God, I mean, you should go to the army, you should fight your enemies. And I grew up for many years like that, believing that this is true, until I was visiting Gaza and Lebanon and actually lost many friends there. And then I started to think, hey, is it actually worth it? What are we actually fighting for? Yeah, defending our country, but why? And I started to have so many friends from the other side, understanding that we are actually the same. And I changed over the years, but it took me at least 10 years or 15 years at the very least to do that transition. And it wasn't because of games. And then when I was involved in games and actually working with developers from Saudi Arabia, from Iraq, even from Iran, that helped me also put things in perspective, even for them to say, hey, the Israelis are not our enemies, actually. So it takes time. But if you try, if you start some of that to the extent in a very early age with your daughter or your son, at least they will grow up with a certain understanding of diversity.
We have time.
Boker Tov.
Hi, Boker Tov. Surprise.
So, have one question.
Yeah.
Actually, manifest like make games, not war. It's a good idea. Mm-hmm. And from your explanation, it's like games after some conflicts. Can game maybe some instrument to prevent some conflicts? Yes or no, and why?
So this is, it's definitely yes when you, and I was speaking about education, and education is actually the root for conflicts. So when you go in certain, it happens even in Israel, but when you go also to Arabic villages, you would hear some of the teachers in Arabic countries, it's the imam that preach the people. And if you listen very carefully and you try to translate, you would hear so much hate. Like those, like Jewish people are your enemies. Why? Because that's written in the Bible. And I wouldn't judge people that believe in God, but in my opinion, religion doesn't need to preach for hate. It needs to preach for, you know, because especially Judaism, Islam and Christianity, which are the belief in one God. I think education is the root for all that. And if you start that in a very early age, those children will be like the generals, like the weapon manufacturers, the educational leaders. And when you try that, although the world is not perfect and it's not optimistic, there will always be conflicts. But you could prevent some of the most, you know, stupid wars about nothing, about ego, at least that. If you can save like 100 people, that would be enough, because then you would actually save people's life. And that everything, it starts from education. And you would see that. And if you are a country that is not investing in its own very diverse education, you got a problem.
Okay, more questions?
Good. We don't have any time for a 2 minutes, 3 minutes video. Do we have? We have? Great, yes. Okay, so I'll just play it again for my huge folder. Sorry, you can see all the assets. Where are you? Don't go. It's the best video. Where are you? Come on. No, I'm trying to look it up. I don't see it. Ah, yes. Ready? Just to see how many conflicts were in each world, like anciently.
This land is mine.
Like higher.
God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. With the help of God, I know.